Hey guys, welcome back to Fins, Scales, and Fluffy Tails. My name is Bryn, and this is Pascal, and today I am finally going to announce the breed of dog that we are getting. And I'm so excited because I have wanted to actually tell you guys and talk about this breed for a while, but I wanted to talk about the other dogs first, and it just didn't seem like the right time. But it was so hard for me to talk about those other breeds without actually telling you guys the breed that we were getting. So, even though I'm going to be announcing this, we will not be getting our dog for a while. It's still gonna be a long time. Alex and I are not married yet. We do have our own house with a yard and all of that now, but our wedding is in July, and so we will not be looking to get a puppy until after the wedding. And even if the puppy is gonna be ready to go home like after the wedding, but even if it's still too close, we'll probably still say no. So it's probably gonna be about 10 months to a year before we actually get a puppy. But as you guys know, I have been doing a ton of research for the past few years, and this breed that I'm gonna talk about, I have gone back and forth and back and forth. And me choosing the two breeds that we're gonna be getting was very hard for me because Alex and I each wanted something different in a dog. At least we thought we did at first. And so it was so hard to choose between, you know, what breed are we getting? What dog are we gonna get first? And I'm a planner, okay? I love planning and making sure that we know exactly what is gonna happen, when it's gonna happen. And if we don't know that, I kind of go a little bit nuts. So, and this could still change, but the first dog that we will be getting within the next year, maybe a little bit less time, is a Shih Tzu. Yes, that is the breed that we have decided on, and I'm gonna go over, you know, I'm gonna talk about the breed, I'm gonna go over why we decided on that breed and why we really like it. And then we've always known that we wanted two dogs. So the second breed that we really want, there is a second breed that we really want, but we probably won't be able to get that one for a little while because we're gonna see, but it will at least be a few years until we get our second dog. But the breed that we have decided on for our second dog is the toy poodle. So we will be getting a female Shih Tzu first, and then we will be getting a male toy poodle second. Now, I don't think I'm gonna have time to talk about the toy poodle in this video because there's a lot I wanna say about the Shih Tzu, but I do want to talk about both breeds. So without further ado, let's talk about the Shih Tzu. So the Shih Tzu is a dog that's in the toy group. So if you watch a dog show in the United States, they're in the toy group. If you watch a dog show in the United Kingdom or in Europe, they're gonna be in the utility group, I believe. It's kind of weird. People, the dog shows in Europe have slightly different classifications for some of the breeds, but at least in the United States, so if you watch the Westminster Dog Show that usually takes place in New York City, the Shih Tzu is gonna be in the toy group. So the Shih Tzu was bred and developed in China. So they say that it kind of originated in Tibet, but the real development of the Shih Tzu and it becoming its own breed happened in China. And this breed, so the Shih Tzu has been its own breed, a pure breed dog, for over 1,000 years. And for some reason, there is a misconception within the Shih Tzu community that you can just take a Lhasa Apso and a Pekingese, mix them together, and you'll get a Shih Tzu. I don't know where that came from, but that is not how genetics works. And that is that you, okay, if you just take a Lhasa Apso and a Pekingese and you breed them together, you have a mutt. It doesn't produce a Shih Tzu. The Shih Tzu is its own pure breed dog. You can't just take two other breeds and put them together and make a purebred dog. That's not how it works. That's called a mutt. So Wherever that came from, that is a myth. That is not how it works at all. However, the Lhasa Apso and the Pekingese were said to be some of the parent breeds for the Shih Tzu, which I can definitely believe. Both of them originated around the same area. The Pekingese was very popular around the same time as the Shih Tzu within Chinese emperors. And the Lhasa Apso, I believe, is from Tibet, where they say the dog originated. However, we don't actually have records that go back that far that say exactly what dogs went into creating the Shih Tzu. So just taking a modern day Lhasa Apso and a modern day Pekingese and mixing them together does not a Shih Tzu make. So, Shih Tzus have a long drop coat if you let it grow, and it is a double coat. So their outer coat is long and silky, and the undercoat is thick and cottony and fluffy. So that's what gives their coat that volume that everyone likes. Now in the shows, they have this little poof on top of their head. That's not natural. They have to use hairspray for that. But they do have that long, fluffy, like drop coat, and that's very beautiful if kept correctly. Shih Tzus are considered hypoallergenic. Now, let me explain what that word means. So in the dog world, hypoallergenic means low shedding. So this hypoallergenic does not mean non-allergenic. Many people think that it is impossible to be allergic to a Shih Tzu because they're quote unquote hypoallergenic. That is not what this word means at all. What it means is that the dog is much less likely to have someone with allergies react to them because they shed less hair. How dog allergies works is that when people are allergic to dog dander, the dander comes off from their skin and is on the hair. And then when the hair is shed from the dog, the dander and the hair float together in the air, which makes people sneeze, makes their eyes runny, and all that bad stuff. When you have a dog that sheds less than, like, say, a Lab or a Pomeranian, then you're going to have less dander in your house because the dander stays on the dog more than it would with a higher shedding breed. Now, I will also say that some people can also, it can be one or the other, or also be allergic to the enzymes in a dog's saliva and their urine. So if your allergies is to their saliva, like if a dog licks you and you get hives, then you probably can't live with any dog. And also, if a person's allergies are very severe, they won't be able to live with any dog breed no matter what. But the reason why we have these hypoallergenic classifications is because people who have less severe allergies, like my fiance, and who are not allergic to the enzymes in urine or saliva, may be able to live without symptoms with a dog who is low shedding. That is what hypoallergenic means. So thankfully, I got lucky with Alex and he can at least be around low shedding breeds. So that is one of the main reasons we picked the Shih Tzu as well. So now we're gonna talk about the health and general well-being of the Shih Tzu. The Shih Tzu is what they call a brachycephalic breed. So what that means is their muzzle, so their mouth and their muzzle is shorter in comparison to the size of their head. And there are many, many breeds that are considered brachycephalic, but all of this means for the Shih Tzu is that they might need some extra accommodation in the summer or in the warmer months. So basically you can do things like give them extra water, make sure they're in the shade, give them a cooling mat, and possibly cut their hair shorter in the summer if they get too hot. Now, I have done a ton of research on this breed and talked to many people. Lots of people go camping and do lots of outdoor activities with their Shih Tzu, so it is possible. However, you'll just have to make sure you accommodate this breed. Like I talked about in my small dog video, Shih Tzus might need some accommodation, but they can absolutely do outdoor activities like hiking, camping, boating, and swimming. But for us, our Shih Tzu will probably have, we'll get her a life jacket for the boat. We'll bring a backpack when we go hiking so she can still come with us. I really want to get our dog a canine sport sack. So that's probably what we'll get her so that she can keep up with us when we go hiking. Because sometimes, you know, Shih Tzus, depending on their personality. Some will be ready to go, go, go and not get tired. Others might be a little bit more on the lazy side, so you might want to bring a backpack for them just in case they don't feel like walking anymore. As far as potential health problems, the Shih Tzu is a pretty healthy breed, especially compared to a lot of other breeds. But as far as stuff that they are can be particularly prone to, one of the biggest ones is IVDD, which stands for intervertebral disc disease. And this is basically back problems. If it gets too bad, they can actually lose mobility in their back legs. So then they'll have to have a little scooter or something to go to walk around. And this disease, IVDD, it can be exacerbated, especially if you get your dog spayed or neutered before 6 months old. So it is for the Shih Tzu breed specifically. In the study, I read a study that was done for this particular breed about early spay and neuter, because I've been also researching that topic. And Shih Tzus that are spayed before they are mature. So in male dogs, this is before their growth plates close. And for female dogs, this when they are spayed before their first heat, they have a much higher chance of getting intervertebral disc disease. And that's specifically for the Shih Tzu. But in general, dogs that are spayed or neutered too early, so before they mature, it can cause bone cancer to go way up. Their risk for bone cancer goes way higher. They can get endocrine issues when they get older. So for me personally, we'll be waiting to spay our Shih Tzu until after her first heat. I'll probably get her spayed between 2 and 3 years old. But I especially want to wait because I don't want her to have as high of a chance of getting IVDD. Another thing that Shih Tzus can have problems with is their eyes. They can sometimes get dystichia, which is ingrown eyelashes, and this can cause them irritation and possibly scratch the surface of their eye. So that is something you might have to watch out for. And teeth problems. So pretty much all small dogs are more prone to teeth problems because their teeth are like really tiny and their mouths are tiny. Shih Tzus and other brachycephalic dogs can have problems with teeth crowding because their mouths are so small and they can have so many teeth that they just kind of crowd each other. Some Shih Tzus do have to get their teeth pulled when this happens, but it just depends on your particular dog. And to also help avoid teeth problems, I will be brushing my dog's teeth hopefully every day, but at least multiple times a week. Mainly because any money that I can save on vet bills by brushing my dog's teeth, I'm going to do it. As far as the AKC goes, the standard for the Shih Tzu is 9 to 16 pounds, and their height should be 9 to 10 and a half inches at the withers. So this is just a general guideline. Some Shih Tzus are going to be smaller and some are going to be bigger, even if you go to a show breeder. But there's lots of colors that they also come in. So I have to read them off my list because there's so many. But the colors that the Shih Tzu is allowed to be shown in and they can come in is golden white, red and white, solid red, gold with a black mask, solid black, black and white, blue and white, brindle and white, liver and white, solid liver, and silver and white. So those are all the colors. And for a dog to be considered blue or liver, their nose cannot be black. So if a dog has a brown nose and then they're like white and brown, then they would be considered a liver. If a dog has like a gray nose and they're like gray and white, that would be considered a blue. So in my research of the colors, their nose cannot be black for them to be considered liver or blue. So that's something interesting too. And I also want to mention that especially with their size, there is no such thing as an Imperial Shih Tzu or a Royal Shih Tzu. Those are just terms that backyard breeders use to try to sell dogs. It's basically a gimmick that they're using to try to make their dogs seem more special. But I would never buy a dog that was labeled an Imperial Shih Tzu, because if it does stay small, which sometimes the breeders just lie, but if it does stay small, it could have a ton of health issues. There's a reason why these AKC standards are set in place, and that is to keep the dog looking, acting, and being as healthy as possible. And a dog that is bred to be super, super tiny can have a ton of issues later on in life. I also don't agree with the breeding of Royal Shih Tzus, which is making them bigger. Like, I've seen people who have a Shih Tzu that weighs almost 30 pounds and it's called a Royal Shih Tzu. I also don't agree with this because making the dogs bigger and bigger messes with their bone structure and all of that. So a breeder should be aiming for this, for like the 9 to 16 pound weight range, to try to keep the dog looking and acting and like it's supposed to look and act, and to keep it as healthy as possible. So even though I talked about a few of the health problems, the Shih Tzu is usually a pretty healthy breed. There's not that many things that can be passed down to them genetically, which is really good. Another one of the main reasons we fell in love with this breed is because we met a few of them and they are such affectionate dogs. They just want to be with you. They want to be in your lap. They want to be held and cuddled. And that is what I love about this breed. I read online that they can be stubborn. However, I don't really consider it stubbornness. I think of them being stubborn as more like they just don't feel like training, or they don't feel like doing what you want them to do. Shih Tzus aren't a super active breed, and so if they don't feel like doing something, they're not gonna do it. Although most dogs are pretty food motivated, so you can train your Shih Tzu that way. At least that's what I'm gonna do. And my Shih Tzu, I'm gonna do probably more training than the average person with my dog because I want a really well-behaved dog. But stubbornness is, that's not with every single Shih Tzu, but it is something I've read. You just have to be patient and consistent, and treats, healthy treats, is what will get your dog to listen to you. Also, this breed is the cutest breed I've ever seen. The cutest. I cannot, every time I went away from them, I was like, no, I don't really want that breed. I want something more athletic. I want something smarter. But then I always came back because of just how cute they are. I just can't take it. I did do my research and I met a couple of them, so I'm not getting this dog just because it's cute, but I love the way this dog looks, and that is a huge plus for me. Shih Tzus do need a lot of grooming if you plan to keep them long, and they are prone to tear stains, especially as puppies, because when they're teething, their eyes will run, and so if you don't keep up with cleaning their face, they're gonna get tear stains. Now, if you get a dog from a good breeder, most dogs who are bred well will outgrow this. However, it really just depends on the dog. I will be keeping my dog in a medium length coat. I don't really like the floor length just because that would be a lot to keep up with. But also, I don't like the shaved look. I can't stand it when people completely shave their dogs down to the skin, mainly because the Shih Tzu looks weird. It was bred, its shape was based around this beautiful flowing coat that it has, and if you shave all their hair off, they look kind of dumpy. The poor things. I always feel so bad when I see them shaved to the skin. And I know that some dogs have to have that done because they can't stand to be brushed and things like that. But I will be working with grooming on with my dog from the very, very beginning. I plan to keep my dog in bows. I absolutely love when the Shih Tzu, when people do their Shih Tzu's hair and the show dogs with those cute little bows. However, if you plan to do that with your Shih Tzu, Maltese, Yorkie, Havanese, any type of dog with that long hair, you have to do it as soon as possible. You have to put the bands in as soon as their hair is long enough, and then as soon as their hair is long enough for a bow, you have to put the bow in. You have to put it in every single day, or else they will never get used to it and they'll never be able to keep a bow in. So pretty much as soon as that puppy comes home, she's gonna have bands in her hair from day one. And another one of the main reasons we're getting this breed is because they were not bred as hunting dogs. They were bred to be companions, so they don't have a high prey drive, which is great because, like I said before, and you guys know this, we have a house rabbit, and I did not want a dog that had a really huge high prey drive and bring that kind of dog into our house with Daisy. So that is all I have for you today about the Shih Tzu breed specifically. Now, The reason why I'm not talking about the toy poodle in this video is because this video is gonna be way too long if I talk about the toy poodle as well. But because we are talking about the Shih Tzu, I feel like I need to mention this in this video. Because over the years of doing my research, I have come across a specific group of people that seems uneducated to me and just unfair in my opinion. And there's a lot of people, not a lot of people, but like a decent number of people who believe that brachycephalic breeds, all of them, should not be bred and should not exist. They believe that we should just let all of them die out and we should not, it should be illegal to keep and breed brachycephalic breeds. And the reasons that they give for this are, and they have, some people have specific reasons for certain breeds, but I'm going to go over the two biggest reasons that these people think that brachycephalic breeds should not exist, and I'm going to prove them wrong. The first reason they think that brachycephalic breeds should not exist is because they need surgery to breathe. And the second reason that they believe they should not exist is because they have health problems. So my first counter argument to they need surgery to breathe is this. Most people, when they get a dog, whether it's a brachycephalic breed or not, will go to backyard breeders. And this includes their neighbor who just decided to have a litter, finding a puppy on Craigslist, looking in the newspaper, just hearing about somebody with a litter by word of mouth, anybody online. They will also go to puppy mills, either by accident, finding somebody online, or on purpose, or they'll go to a pet store to buy their puppy. I personally don't know anyone that like I've met in person and I talk to them regularly and I know them who has gotten their brachycephalic dog from a show breeder who has the best quality dogs, the healthiest dogs, and the best breeding stock. And that goes for any brachycephalic breed because, like I said, most people, when they want a dog, they just go out and buy one. They want the cheapest puppy possible. They're not concerned really about health, and they don't go to a show breeder because they don't want a show, so they just find the first puppy, they just buy the first puppy they can find. And so this means that they're starting out with the unhealthiest stock already. So they bought a puppy with very poor genetics. And honestly, their dog probably does need surgery to survive because if it didn't, like, it would probably not be able to breathe because the breeder just slapped two dogs together and decided to make a litter so they could make money. And that is usually what happens. Another thing is many vets aren't familiar with specific breeds. In the Shih Tzu breed specifically, many vets will actually suggest that an owner get Neuter surgery for their dog way too early. So Shih Tzu puppies can have a slight problem breathing during the teething stage because their mouth is hurting, which causes their sinuses to swell, and then they can snort a little more than usual, and inexperienced vets or vets that want your money will see that, and then they will tell you, you need to get your puppy spayed by 6 months old and we're gonna fix the nares at the same time. So they charge you, the owner, more money for the surgery, and 9 times out of 10, the puppy will outgrow those breathing problems that the vet saw was a problem that needed to be fixed by surgery. So that already throws off the statistics. And the reason I know that is because I've been doing a lot of research. I've been in contact with the show breeder that we're on a waiting list for this Shih Tzu. She has this on her website, and many people in the Shih Tzu Facebook groups I'm in say that their vets are wanting their puppy to get Neuter surgery at like 12 weeks old. And that is way too early, way too early. And most of the time the vets don't have enough experience with Shih Tzus to know the difference between a real breathing problem and puppy teething. And as far as the second reason, brachycephalic breeds have health problems, therefore they shouldn't exist. My argument is all purebred dogs have health problems. I don't care which purebred dog you think is the healthiest. I can bet you that there are certain things that those show breeders have to test for in their lines, because all purebred dogs can be prone to something. It doesn't matter what breed it is, even your beloved lab. But my point is that Cavalier King Charles Spaniels are prone to SM, which is a horrible and painful neurological disorder, and heart issues. German Shepherd dogs have a terrible time with hip dysplasia. Golden Retrievers are very, very prone to cancer. Many of them die before they reach 10 years old due to cancer. And Great Danes have very short lifespans, so they only live about 7 years. They're very prone to heart problems and bloat, extremely prone to bloat. Many Great Danes actually die of bloat, which is very, very sad. Whereas the Shih Tzu barely has any health problems and lives 10 to 18 years. That is double the lifespan of a Great Dane, but Shih Tzus don't have a right to exist? That makes no sense to me, not at all. And my point is that people, if they want a certain dog, that is perfectly fine, but they should be going to a breeder who is purposely trying to breed for healthy dogs. Because if you go to just anybody for a dog, you don't know what you're getting. And regular people don't do health testing on their dogs, whereas the show breeders do. They are required by the AKC, at least for the large breeds. The large breed dogs, so the AKC has different breed clubs for all their different breeds. All of the breed clubs for large breeds require their breeders that go through the AKC to do testing on their dogs, and that is called OFA testing. Pretty much all large breeds have to be tested for eyes and hips. And this is an actual blood test. This isn't just a regular health checkup by the vet. This is an actual test where the vet will maneuver the joint or look in the eyes. It's very specific. And then not only do they have to do the eyes and hips, but they have to test other things that are specific for that breed as well. Now, the Shih Tzu Club of America doesn't have specific tests that they require their breeders to do. In all honesty, most small dog breed clubs don't require a lot of testing. But in my opinion, the show breeders still do have the best quality and healthiest stock because they are breeding their animals with care. They're taking them to the vet regularly. They're going to know if there ends up being a problem in their lines because they are keeping records of it. If they know that they bred two dogs together and it produced a terrible health condition, they won't breed those two dogs ever again, and they'll probably retire them from breeding and showing. And also, show breeders have a much better knowledge about dog genetics than just your run-of-the-mill backyard breeder who just slapped two dogs together to breed a litter and make money. And show breeders are also breeding to the AKC standard. They're not breeding little tiny Imperial Shih Tzus that could die from heart problems or spinal problems. They're not trying to breed huge Shih Tzus just for the gimmick to make more money. They're trying to breed the best and healthiest dogs that they can. So that is all I have to say about that. Thank you guys so much for watching this video. I cannot wait to get my puppy sometime next year. I will be filming the entire process because I am so excited already, as you guys can tell. I cannot wait to bring her home. And I was so excited that I couldn't wait to make this video. So thank you guys so much. If you like my content, don't forget to hit that subscribe button and the bell down below. And don't forget to follow us on Instagram if you want to see more pictures. And I will catch you guys on the next one.